Thank you, everyone. Thanks, Armin and Elisa, for presenting your work. That, like, my work is also like highly relevant to what you guys already presented. So this is my job market paper work in rural Tanzania, where I try to create some like digital job platform to improve some like labor market function for rural farmers. So let me just start with the brief motivation. So basically, the motivation for me to study the rural labor markets is because when you look at sub-Saharan Africa, as you already know, like the vast majority of those farms belong to smallholder farmers. And for them, the labor is by far the biggest factor input to agricultural production naturally, because they do not have access to high-tech agricultural machines. When you look at the literature, you find there's a lot of evidence that consistent with the imperfections in agricultural labor markets, in a sense that the wages are not adjusting fully to allocate labor resources across farms and the villages. And the question that I want to ask here is, what is basically the source of labor market imperfection and what is causing these labor markets to fail? So one source of imperfection that I'm focusing on here is basically search and information frictions in rural villages. So when you think about the rural villages, you can imagine that the search and coordination is actually quite costly, because in these rural areas, villages tend to be large in Tanzania, and they're also much more sparsely populated relative to like urban areas. So from farmers' perspective, it is difficult to know like where and when these jobs are available, and also it isn't clear at what wages these jobs are being offered. So the facts that I found in my study setting is that the farmers, as a result, they do not engage extensively in searching for jobs or searching for workers, but rather they rely on their existing set of workers they already know, or the existing set of small set of employers they already know. So they rely on social network for hiring or for searching for jobs and workers. And as a result, these labor markets are like quite local in a sense that it's like fragmented with a very small size of players. And I find that there is like large wage dispersion even within the village. So the question that I'm trying to answer here is, given the fact that I find there is wage dispersion, and how much of these observed wage dispersion is explained by search frictions? So there is some existing work on like the agricultural commodity price dispersion, but there is a very little work on the rural labor market wage dispersion. And also, when you look at macro labor literature, there's a debate on like how important this kind of search frictions is in terms of explaining wage dispersion. So some literature find that the frictional wage dispersion is as large as 50% of the wage dispersion you see, while other papers find that it doesn't explain more than 10% of the wage dispersion you see. So the way I went about answering this question is I basically experimentally developed on SMS-based messaging application that can connect agricultural workers and employers. So the way this application works is that there is a, I think you can see my pointer as well here. There is a master gateway phone where I built like the automated message replies. So the way the system works is that the employer can first post the job by sending an SMS message. Then this master phone is going to ask some questions about the jobs and process those information and put it into a job ad and send it to a large number of workers, in the village. So these workers then can just receive the job ad in their cell phone, but sitting in their home, and they can apply to the job by sending a text, or if they recognize the name of the employer, then they can just go directly to the employer's house or call the employer directly. But if they reply to the job ad by text message, then again, this main gateway phone send those applications back to the employer who initiated the request. And so this is a type of phones that are commonly used in rural Africa. So this is a 2G phone. And that's why I had to develop this system using a text message based application. And more specifically, the way the job posting and job application works is that so employer can first send a text called "Wafanya Kazi," meaning like they're looking for workers, and then the system automatically replies to those requests by sending what kind of task is this, and then what kind of crop is this, and then ask when does the job start, and then how much do you want to pay per day or per acre. And that's, so it basically sends like six short messages to collect basic job information. And then once this job is information is collected, then the gateway phone sends this job ad to the workers. So there are two workers as an example I'm showing you. This employer is looking for workers for harvesting and starting today in this particular village, and the wage is this much. And then the workers can apply to this job by sending a text, and then the application asks how much would you like to get paid for this job. And the same for the second worker. And the step three is employer receives those offers in their cell phones. So that's how this job application that I developed works. And on top of that, I also randomized whether I show the wage information in the job ad and in the worker application. And the idea is that I wanted to isolate the impact of explicitly disclosing the wage in the job ad and job application from just sharing the availability of jobs and workers. So the only difference between the disclosed version and non-disclosed version is basically you see the wage in the job ad or not. And then also same thing for the worker application, you see the wage that the worker wants to get paid or not between the two versions. So just to summarize, this is my treatment design. So in total, I have 70 villages, and there are 30 control villages with the, and then the 40 treatment villages. And then the 40 treatment villages are assigned to each cell here, depending on whether those villages are able to see the job wage in the job ad versus, and also the wages in the job application. So just a little bit of context and how my intervention was actually implemented. So this is a agricultural cycle of rural Tanzania. So the planting season is roughly during the, February and March, followed by weeding period and then the harvest. And then there's a short rain from like September to the next February. And then this is a 2019 agricultural season. And so I collected data of their hiring events, like at what date they hired workers and how many workers they hired and how much they paid. And through a survey, because I wanted my results to be comparable between treatment and villages and control villages. So control villages, because I was not giving out any application or tool, so my analysis that you're gonna see later in the slides is going to rely on the phone survey and then the in-person surveys I conducted in both control and treatment villages in a comparable way. And my intervention was rolled out during February 2019 agricultural season through village meetings. So basically we went to these villages and we explained what our technology is, and then we registered farmers if they wanted to register for this kind of service. So this is just a picture of the village meeting, and this is how we asked people to bring their cell phones so that they can register automatically to my system. Again, the registration was done automatically by sending a simple text, and then they could choose to register either as a worker or as an employer. So there was a restriction in the registration that with the one cell phone number, you could only register as either worker or employer. So overall, this application has been used by a lot of farmers. So in 2019 agricultural season, They were so they had access to use this app throughout the entire agricultural season until like after harvest in September. And I find that in total, there are like 1,000 jobs have been announced, and then these job ads were sent to more than 1,000 unique workers several times, and also there were a lot of there were roughly 1,500 job applications that the system received as well. So the way that I examine my main outcome is basically my main outcome is the dispersion in these villages. So remember, the objective of this study is just to quantify the size of the search frictions that contribute to the wage dispersion. So the dispersion is measured using the standard ways. So there's a standard deviation in particular village and agricultural stage S, and then the coefficient of variation and the percentile wage ratio. So the median person's wage versus like 10th person's like wage, and then the average and minimum ratio as well. And here, TV is basically the treatment dummy, whether village V belongs to treatment group or not. And then this post is whether the agricultural stage S is after the village meeting date, which proxies for the intervention. So whether the hiring event happened after the village meeting date versus like before the village meeting date. And then this is the time production stage fixed effect. So this is basically a definitive specification where the exogenous source of variation is coming from my randomization. And there is no main effect of the time because that's observed in this like stage fixed effects. So graphically, when I look at the dispersion between the control and treatment villages, so in this figure, that's the before intervention, and I'm plotting the deviation of individual wage from the average village wage. So first of all, you can see that there's a dispersion. So some people in the village are paying like $2 to $3 less than average village wage, and some people are paying like $3 or $4 more than average village wage. But between the control and treatment group, the dispersion looks pretty similar. But after the intervention, you can see that in the treatment villages, the fraction of people who pay lower than the average and the fraction of people who are paying more than average are reduced, and the wage overall is compressed for the village average. And this is a table version of the result. So I'm looking at the outcome using the wage as well as wage and non-monetary benefits that includes food and drinks. But across these columns, you basically see that the standard deviation has significantly reduced relative to the control group standard deviation. And this is also robust to other measures, coefficient of variation and the wage ratios as well. So roughly it's 20 to 40% of the variation in the wage dispersion is caused can be explained by my treatment. So far basically my main goal was to quantify the size of the wage dispersion that is attributable to the search frictions, but in this section, I try to get at some of the mechanisms, what is causing the reduction precisely, what is causing the reduction in the wage dispersion. So the question that I'm trying to answer here is basically, so who is updating the wage, who is changing the wage, and whether my mechanism is that I'm trying to, my job platform is basically connecting different subsets of local labor market clusters within the village that were not previously connected. So the second piece of mechanism that I look at is whether there is expansion on the hiring network, in the sense that whether you start hiring workers whom you had not interacted previously. And third, whether including explicit wage information in the job as in job application contributed to the wage compression at all. So first, I identified the employers in two groups. So the employer who used to pay a lower wages relative to other employers in the village at baseline, and also the employers who used to pay higher wages at baseline relative to other employers. And I tracked them how they update their wages over time. So this is a control group. So there's somewhat like trend, a little bit of upper increasing trend of for both the control and treatment group. But when you look at the treatment group, the people who used to pay higher wages now like reduced the wage. And then the people who used to pay lower wages, there's a like suggestive evidence that they increase the wage. So essentially I'm finding that the my job platform is affecting there's a distributional effect that some people get affected differently. So these high paying employer reduce the wage and the low paying employer increase the wage, and as a result, we are seeing the compression in the wage dispersion. So in this regression specification, I interact my main treatment effect with the indicator whether this particular employer is low paying employer at baseline and whether there are high paying employers at baseline. So these odd columns are basically the interacting those interaction effects, whereas these even columns are interacting my treatment effect with the baseline, the pre-intervention period, standardized wage deviation. So, but the overall picture that I'm trying to say here is that there's a little bit of like modest evidence that for some subset of employers, especially those who pay higher wages, that they also tend to increase the fraction of workers, they also tend to increase the probability of hiring a new worker whom they had not interacted previously. And also they increase the fraction of workers among those fraction of the new workers that they had not hired previously among those like labor force. The third mechanism that I wanted to explore is whether there's any effect of those, the wage disclosure. So here the treat B dummy is defined as one. If that particular village had access to the wage information, the job ad or job application. But as you can see from this result, this third row is basically the main effect that I found previously. So there's a large reduction for villages who did not have access to those wage information. But if you look at the fourth row, there is no additional effect of reducing wage dispersion across all columns. So indicating that this suggests that potentially sharing job information and job availability or worker availability alone are sufficient to lower the wage dispersion in the village. And there is a little effect of sharing those wage information more explicitly. So just to summarize all of this, so I'm finding that the search frictions explain like 20 to 40% of the observed wage dispersion, which I think is an important addition to the literature that because we were not sure. So this is the first study that was done experimentally to try to quantify the size of frictional wage dispersion, whereas the previous literature tended to rely on structural models and calibrated to the data. And so what's the significance of like those reduction in the wage dispersion? The first bullet point is that I'm just trying to relate these reduction in wage dispersion with the functioning of the labor market. The first bullet point is that I'm finding that when I look at the amount of labor input per acre across farms, I'm finding that there is a like 20 to 30% reduction in labor input dispersion. So what it means is that previously before my intervention, farmer A and farmer B, they tended to use a very different amount of labor per their acre. So, but now after my intervention, the intensity of their labor resources on their given unit of land becomes similar as a result of my intervention, indicating that my intervention potentially has improved the functioning of the labor markets. And when I look at other the harvest outcomes, I'm finding that there's a small, it's insignificant, statistically insignificant, but there's a positive increase in harvest. And I also find that there is a large reduction in the probability of skipping a meal for treatment villages. And I think the mechanism there is maybe that my app kind of enables those workers in poverty to find jobs more easily. And one last thing that I wanted to mention before I end my talk is the potential scalability of this job application. So in my user feedback survey, almost all users like told me that this app was actually very useful for them to find jobs and find workers much more easily with little effort. And when I asked their willingness to pay, the farmers are also willing to pay for this kind of service, like $1.5 per agricultural season. So basically, when I translate this to when I multiply this number of users I have, then because it's the cost of the maintenance cost of this job platform is like really low, and it's already like large enough to cover my system and to operate the system in a sustainable way. So I think that's so potentially this is something that can be scaled up, and in my future study I want to replicate this in different settings and to see how it works in other areas of Tanzania. Thank you, everyone.
Thanks so much, DJ. That was fantastic. And I'll open it up to questions from Elisa and Armand.
Okay, thank you, DJ. This is very interesting and kind of impressive work to make this happen. I have one, maybe I missed some of the details. I just want to ask a clarification question. Whether there were any restriction of the same employer sending out, advertising their job multiple times, especially starting from a wage, and then, you know, if you don't get any answer, can I decrease the wage that I'm offering? Like, what were the restrictions into that maybe? And how, if there were restriction or no restriction especially, how do you categorize the same worker, the same employer sending out multiple messages and the frequency of those messages in your analysis where you look at employer that were offering low versus high? Sorry if I missed some of the details on the implementation.
Sorry. So there were no restrictions on the number of jobs the employers could post. So they could post as many times and they could update their job ad. Mm-hmm. So in terms of the using the technology, there were no restrictions. They could use it like as freely as they wanted. And in terms of my analysis, is not relying on the job platform data, unfortunately, because I don't have a comparable data for the control group. Oh. So my entire analysis is based on the high frequency, like the monthly phone surveys that I conducted to ask about their hiring and the wage they paid, and also in-person interviews that I conducted during like harvest time. So yeah, I was able to capture for both control and treatment group the
yeah,
hiring
that makes
event
sense.
Level.
You said that. Yeah, that makes sense. Yeah, thank you.
Yeah, sure.
Awesome. Yeah, awesome paper.
Thank you very much.
Yeah. Really cool and nice to see the platform lowering wages version. I guess I already looked at the Q&A and Josh asked a question that is similar to what I was going to ask, so I will skirt away from that because he does it better than me. But I'm sort of mainly interested in the thinking through the social welfare implications, because often, right, we see this market as becoming more efficient from the wage dispersion sense, but does that, there's winners and losers. It looks from the figures like maybe the owner, the firm folks hiring labor are winning more in the sense that they're able to pay lower wages. So that's sort of one thing, and that relates to Josh's question. But the thing I wanted to ask is more the dynamics of, do you see things working in the way you'd expect in terms of competition? So let's say there's a day where a bunch of job ads are posted, do you see wages go down? And this could be just in treatment villages if that's the only place you have data. I'm just curious if you see these sort of dynamics that you would expect, or if the, a bunch of sort of more applications for a given job, that should imply lower wages too, right? Like, are you seeing that it's actually, I guess this is similar to Lisa's question, like that the mechanism, the market's working as you would expect. And then the second question is, you're saying sort of lower reduction in probability of skipping a meal. Can you say anything about just unemployment? Because to me, that would be the obvious, it's like an extensive versus intensive margin of wages go down, but maybe now I can actually get hired. And do we see more people working? And that could lead towards increases in social welfare. I'll stop there.
Yeah, so those social welfare aspects are, I'm still trying to wrap my head around to understand better. But just to answer your question, so I'm not unfortunately be able to look at like competition and how that affects like the wages people get paid, because so when you look at a given village, there is a very, the frequency of these like events are low. So from individual like employer's perspective, you typically hire like 2 to 3 times per season. So this is like infrequent events from individual employer's perspective. So when I look at the data, I rarely have days where more than more than 2 or 3 employers like post a job together. So yeah, unfortunately, there's little I can say about the effect of competition and the wage. And for your second question, whether there's any social welfare effects and like unemployment level. So I think that's a great question, but again, when I look at the data, I look at whether there's an increase in total employment or the wage, but I did not find any change in the average wage in the results that I did not report in this presentation. And also there's no change in the total employment. So I think one explanation for this is because maybe because I'm targeting these smallholder farmers, even on the employer's perspective, there is a friction, and this job platform is addressing frictions on both sides, both workers and both employers. So I think it's a little ambiguous in terms of how this platform is gonna benefit one side over the other. But just to answer your question, the only welfare impact I was able to find is the increase in the harvest, insignificant, but increase in the harvest, and also the probability of reduction in the probability of skipping a meal for the workers. But no change in the average wage and no change in the employment at the village level. I think that's because this labor market in these villages are like pretty thin. There's a little margin to improve gain.
I have one follow-up question, which is, did you at all try to ask about fairness? I'm just surprised that wages would go down, because usually wages mean sticky downward, going downward, especially, and I know other people have done recent studies looking at wages in rural villages in, say, India, and they find they're pretty sticky. Do you have a sense of unhappy, or did you ask about this at all at NLine?
Yeah, so I didn't ask about whether they were upset or anything. So, but when I was talking to like employers, like they were, I think that the employers were like open to hiring like new workers if those new workers were better. So I initially thought that there might be some social reasons why employers would stick to a certain set of workers that they always interact like every season. But when I was talking to those employers, they were actually indifferent between hiring their old workers versus like workers that are new to them, which suggests that at least in my study setting, they're not as sensitive to those like social norms. But it might be different in settings with the from India and like rural Africa.
Great. I may have missed it, but just going to read out Josh's question in case there's parts of it you haven't answered, but I think you did answer some of it. So it looks like wage compression is driven entirely by the high wage employers lowering wages rather than low wage employers increasing wages. So does this say anything, or can you say anything about how this affects worker welfare or surplus total wages received by the workers, for example?
So I mentioned that the average wage did not change, and I haven't looked at the total wages received by workers. I only looked at just the wage rate received by worker, which did not change. But from the employer side, there was no change in the total employment. But I can take a look at how the total wage compensation changed at all from the workers' side.